Speaking Earthlings, if you follow the channel, you know that we are resurrecting the Apollo communication system with original spacecraft and NASA ground equipment. In the previous episode, we finally managed to send a digital command from the ground to the spacecraft via the Up Data Link, or UDL for short. And this should be a message to turn a relay on. Oh! What an achievement! For that, we first had to crack the subic codes used to encode the information, which we did by building a Franken HP phase shift keying transmitter. We now have a pretty good handle on the codes. I was even able to introduce single subbit errors at will, which were correctly detected by the command module UDL receive box. Let me put a bad bit in there.
Yeah, let's do that.
I put it in the last bit of the payload.
Yeah, we got an error.
Where's your error?
The error is right here, where the cursor is.
Yeah, that's it. Now, we also have an original NASA test UDL transmitter that we had tried first, but that did not work. At the time, we thought it was using the wrong block 1 subbit codes, but we later also found that our UDL receiver was misconfigured. After we found the proper UDL receiver configuration and the right subbit thanks to the HP contraption, we were surprised to find that our NASA box was transmitting the right codes all along.
So this is what I'm seeing coming out of the updated link box.
Well, it sends the right code. It sends
the
right thing.
It was sending the right code.
So, wow.
So we tried the NASA UDL transmitter again, but it still did not work.
So we'll switch to the Apollo UDL.
Yeah, we better write down where the correct subbits are now that we found it. We can. Are you getting good data?
It's airing up pretty quick. There's no vehicle address match.
So there's still more going on in that original NASA transmitter that's preventing it to work. We really want to fix that in this episode. Okay, so finally we're able to send a command to the spacecraft, but we haven't done it yet with the actual NASA box. We have still an issue there. We send message.
Nothing. It didn't change at all. Notice the polarity is inverting again.
So
there's an inversion happening somewhere.
Moments later.
And I think we just prove what's wrong with our NASA box. And the orange signal is the one we sent that just triggered the relay as it should. So that's the correct message. And when I try the same message on the box, it's exactly the polarity is inverted. So we have a polarity inversion, which in PSK shouldn't happen, right? Because the polarity of the audio signal shouldn't matter at all. It's just the phase of the two signals.
Interesting.
So we have to do a rewire of the NASA box, somehow figure out why it's wrong or if I did something wrong when I modified it.
Do we know that our test box didn't come from Australia?
I find it really hard to believe that they would have changed the polarity between missions. We found 3 different versions of the bit code, and none is the one that works.
Right.
So, well, maybe they did change the polarity at one point, and then we got stuck with A doesn't talk to B, but it's pretty close. So we have to talk to Ken, who couldn't stay that long because we would need to rewire that machine. We're getting closer.
Yeah.
1 week later.
So we suspect the box is generating the wrong polarity, and we just scratch our heads why that would be. And for that in PSK, it has to be that the 2 kHz is 180 out of phase with the 1 kHz, because they use a combo of the two to regenerate the signal. So we're trying to look at that, and I'm right in the middle for the transitions here. I hooked it up temporarily to an external 4 kHz reference so I can tune it, and you can see that as soon as I go off, I am off resonance of the 2 kHz. So my circuit seems to be totally smack on. So that's not it. So I get the ride home free card. Then I say, well, your box not good.
Well, the thing is, it takes the 4 kilohertz, divides it down to 2 kilohertz, divides it down to 1 kilohertz. So it's generating all the timings internally. So there's nothing that should make it go off.
Right.
Except I looked closely and I had made a note that there was a modification on the board where they're taking the 1 kilohertz off the Q rather than the Q bar output from the flip-flop. So it looks like they modified the circuit to flip the 1 kilohertz signal, which would have the same effect more or less as changing your bits. So it looks like they modified this box sometime post-Apollo to invert the polarity, to confuse us.
So we pull the board and revert the modification?
Yeah.
That would explain it, right? Because it makes absolutely no sense that the thing would be out of phase.
Oh, I see. So they just cut the Q bar connection, and then they took the Q out and they wired that over with the patch wire. So we should be able to see that.
That would be that board, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yep.
Oh.
Nice and easy.
One of those wires?
No, it's this thick white one right here, right? Because that goes to that pin here.
And then the cut trace is on the other side, so we can't see it.
So there's a bunch of rework here done with a thin white wire.
Mm-hmm.
But the one that we're interested in is this wire here, which is thicker than the others. It's still white, but we can tell that it was done at a different time because it's a different type of wire.
Can you show the other side?
Yeah, so then if we look at the other side...
Yeah, you can see the cut right here.
Yeah, like this.
Oh, I see it.
Right here.
Right there. Yeah, I see it. Okay. So there was actually a big bad mod. Many episodes ago, out of sheer persistence and brain power, Master Ken was able to reverse engineer the mysterious UDL test transmitter and draw its schematics. This page shows board A2, the board that performs the PSK modulation and has apparently been previously modified. The board is clocked by a 4 kHz signal that had been removed from board A1, but that we replaced in episode 18. The clock makes it to a first divide by 2 stage, implemented by a flip-flop. Out comes the reference 2 kHz, the frequency that this board will phase shift to encode the digital information. It then hits another divide by 2 and out comes the 1 kHz, the continuous reference tone that we will send along with the phase shifted 2 kHz. But our board has been modified. The trace from pin 14 was cut and instead rewired to pin 15 of the flip-flop. This inverts the phase of the reference 1 kHz by 180 degrees, which, if we understand this correctly, should be the cause for our bits received by our UDL being inverted during decoding. And while we're at it, let's explain how they achieve PSK modulation with such a paucity of circuits. The 2 kHz reference is picked up and directed towards a resonant 2 kHz circuit, which was also missing from our box, but which we also replaced. This will transform the square wave into a sine wave, which is fed to coil L1 through an amplifier. Coil L1 is the primary of a transformer, the big black square on the board. The output of this transformer has two coils, one that picks up an in-phase signal, and one that's wound reverse and produces the out-of-phase signal. The coils are switched in and out of the circuit by a switch, which simply grounds the coil in use. The switch is controlled by a driver, which receives the sub-bits. So depending on the value of the sub-bit received, the 2 kHz sine coming out of the circuit will either be in or out of phase. Simple and efficient. Meanwhile, the 1 kHz is picked up from the divider, transformed into a 1 kHz sine wave by our formerly missing resonant circuit, and then forwarded to the summing point at a summing amplifier, to be added in analog fashion to the 2 kHz PSK signal. And out comes our lovely PSK audio tone, which we transmit to the command module. What we are planning to do is to return the 1 kHz to its original configuration by detaching the bodge wire that's connected to pin 15 and reattaching it to the original pin 14 location, which has the opposite output polarity. That should invert our 1 kHz reference signal phase and cause the UDL receiver to invert the polarity of the decoded sub-bits. Or so we hope.
There we go.
Or you just move it to the next turret where, so it replaces the wire that had been cut.
Exactly. Yeah.
All right, try it.
There we go. Right. Okay.
So we're back up. It's working. I see data. Okay. So now we are now transmitting with our remodified box. And see if we can receive it. See something?
Yeah, there's hold on.
You have to slide it a bit.
How am I supposed to do that?
Let me.
Alright.
I'll show you.
So I should be turning it on.
Well, no, it's still inverted. It didn't invert it.
Hmm.
It's still completely inverted. Despite our modification.
Right.
Yeah, it's perfectly inverted, isn't it?
Yeah.
So modification unsuccessful for some reason.
Something right?
So we're not convinced that our mod did anything. We changed something, but it also changed another timing down the down the line. It was self-compensating.
I think it shifted the bit clock.
So we're going to try another modification instead. Well, folks, that did not work. Ken and Eric tell me it's because we also changed the polarity of the 1 kHz that comes out of the last gate and is used someplace else in the box to clock in the sub-bits. So we shifted the sub-bits timing and that self-cancelled our modification. So let's go to plan B. We are going to remove our unmodification of the modification and get the 1 kHz back as we found it. Instead, we are going to invert the 2 kHz by disconnecting the pickup point and moving it to the inverted output of the first flip-flop. That should just invert the 2 kHz and do the trick. Or so we hope. So you're undoing the previous mod?
That's correct.
We got that to over there, which essentially shifted the polarity of that.
It did, but then it also affected this, which presumably is the bit clock.
Right, and that didn't do us any good because it self-compensated. So the other way is try to have the opposite polarity of the 2 kHz over here, which should shift what comes into my filter and flip it.
Mm-hmm.
We think, kind of, sort of, maybe. So you need to do a little bit of cutty-cutty to get that done.
Yes, that's right.
You know what, we should have put it in a different color. we'll do a little David, whatever, Landsberg note. Let's say what we did. Connected pin such and such to pin such and such. Let's try this again. Okay, 4601. Send.
There.
Oh, works.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. We got it. So that was it.
Right there. Yeah, the 4600.
No, I don't have the anti. The reset one.
Alright, let's turn that off.
Okay, so but it received the command, it turned on the stuff, and let me take an oscillogram on it and see what actually happened. So, try to capture our new sequence here after the second mod. And if I turn the reference on, how do I do that? We don't have two scopes the same. Ref. Display ref. R1, there you go, and we'll see if we got the same thing. Oh yeah, we changed the face. The reference is the brown. That's the one I took before the mod, and then now we have the yellow, so we just inverted the thing. So we're trying to make new command tips, see if we can turn a few relays on and off. And then first you have to get this really cryptic sequence of commands on, which is all special characters, and then you have to send it. Send file. The update 8. And open. Then go over here. Okay, done. Hopefully this is a good one. We made a few bad ones. Okay, 000 got the start. All right, that's first command 4601. That's abort relay 1. 4600 clears it. Relay 1 again. Use it. 4607, that's abort relay 2. 4606, that's clearing that relay. Try again. Yeah, we got it. Let's try that. So how are you going to see that on your side, Mike?
I've got two different multimeters.
Oh, you have two? Do they beep differently?
Yes, they do.
Okay, can you reset the... Is it clear with your special reset button?
I can't reset the first abort relay, I can only reset the second one.
Okay, well, we'll see. Okay, that should do button. That should do relay 1. Turn it off. Relay 1 again. Turn it off. Relay 2. Woo! Turn it off.
Easy.
We are sending commands, so we can fly to the moon. This is how it works. You could send commands to the AGC this way.
Uh-huh.
It would work. We don't have the AGC anymore. But we have the CTE, so we could try to reset the time on the CTE to send something a bit more complicated than just flipping relays.
Mm-hmm.
But phew, we got UDL working.
We
Yay!
Did it. Yeah.
It looks like we did it. We have the updata link working. It also looks like more command tapes are in our future, so we can try to remotely light up more appropriate displays, change the time of our CTE, and play with our diski from the ground. We'll leave that for our next episode, and we'll also show you how it was done from the consoles on the ground, which fortunately did not involve tapes in normal operation. See you then!